Welcome to the Quantum Leaps first ever magazine show, Kaleidoscope, where we take you to a breathtaking, colorful world
through a never-ending array of beautiful art with ever-changing themes.
Hi, I'm Mariel.
And I'm Rihanna.
And we are your Kaleidoscope hosts, spreading the hues in you.
So sit back, relax, and enjoy the first episode of
Kaleidoscope.
All Souls Day, a Christian holiday celebrated worldwide in commemoration of all the faithful departed. On Quantum at Home, let's go back in time and learn about the history of one of our most loved childhood toys, the Kaleidoscope. Ever wondered how Halloween came to be? Come join us on Think Talk, where we think and talk about the roots of one of the most fun and exciting holidays of the year. Still want to feel the Halloween vibe with your family? Well, get ready as we serve you something spooky on The Scoops. Feeling sad because you weren't able to visit the cemetery and physically attend Mass last All Souls Day? Well, say no more because we got you covered on Teas and Stories.
Rihanna, it's been so long since I last saw you. So, how are you?
I missed you so much, Mariel. And well, the pandemic took a toll on us all, but I'm doing great now.
That is so great to hear. And you know, I'd never thought that we'd be here right now, and everything just feels so surreal.
Oh, I agree with you.
Oh, by the way, where's Debbie?
I'm not so sure about that. Oh, why don't we call her?
Yeah, let's wait. While we wait for her, let's go talk about anything. So, what have you been up to?
Well, I've been reading more books. I've been getting to watch.
Oh! Hi, Debbie!
Hi, Debbie!
Hello, everyone. It's so lovely to see you guys, and I'm happy to be here.
Oh my God, Debbie, I'm so happy you called. By the way, why are you here with us?
Well, bestie Rihanna called me last minute to join you. Unfortunately, I can't physically be there, which is why I'm joining you through the screen.
I thought it would be a marvelous idea to have Debbie on the show. Plus, it might get a bit lonely, you know, as the show goes on.
Mm-hmm. I totally get what you mean, you know. The more, the merrier. Ugh, I'm so thrilled.
Aw, that's so sweet. Thanks, guys. Anyway, since many of us just celebrated All Souls Day, do you guys ever wonder how the holiday came to be? I mean, I understand why we celebrate it, but I never learned much about its history.
Oh yeah, I've actually thought about that too, Debbie. But luckily, we have Clarice to answer all our questions about All Souls Day.
Really? So, what are we waiting for? Let's start the show.
All right. Please give a warm welcome to Clarice O'Neila on Spotlight.
It's time to turn up the lights. Good day to you all. I'm Clarice O'Neila, sharing the spotlight, and right now, you're watching Spotlight, where stories are brought to light. For this episode of Spotlight, we'll be shining the light on a group of Roman Catholics. All Souls Day, ang araw ng mga patay, or Undas, as we Filipinos like to call it. If you look at all of your yearly calendars, or if you search it up on the internet, you'll find this holiday marked on the 2nd of November. The day after All Saints Day, November 1st.
All Souls Day is a celebration among the Catholics to respect the dead or their loved ones, yung mga mahal nila sa buhay, para tuloy pa rin yung connection ng family doon sa mga mahal nila sa buhay na
the history of All Souls Day could be traced all the way back to 1048 AD. It began when the Abbot of Cluny, Saint Odilo, declared that the said day will be a day of prayer. He wanted everyone to dedicate this day to all of our dearly departed, especially those who may have been suffering in limbo or purgatory.
Good day, everybody. My name is John. I am an Elevate lay volunteer here in Northern Mindanao. Now, each branch of the church or all of the different branches of the church have specific and unique histories and consequent approaches when it comes to All Souls Day. The Roman Catholic Church has the official name for the event as the commemoration of all the faithful departed. Originally, though, this feast day was celebrated around Easter time, maybe around May, April, but was eventually moved to November 2 after All Saints Day. Unless the second day falls on a Sunday, in which case All Souls Day will be moved to the 3rd, which is something that we don't necessarily practice now, but they used to back then. Roman Catholics pray, they celebrate Mass, they visit the graves of their loved ones, sometimes they give alms for the believers, because they typically believe in purgatory, in hopes that the souls of their loved ones would be released into heaven. And also the rest of November is spent praying for the dead.
In the Roman Catholic doctrine, it says that praying for our loved ones who have passed away will cleanse and purify their souls of their sins, so that they may finally rest in peace.
Hello, I'm Caleb, and I'm an Elevate D member. Many people don't know the difference between All Saints Day and All Souls Day. In fact, they think that they're the same thing, but they're actually two separate celebrations. All Saints Day is celebrated on November 1, and All Souls Day is celebrated on November 2. According to Reverend Richard Donahoe, pastor of Our Lady Queen of the Universe Catholic Church in Birmingham, All Saints Day is a celebration of the communion of saints, those people we believe are in heaven, through good works and God's grace. It is actually also a feast day. On the other hand, All Souls Day is a day to pray for all souls of the dead. Among Catholics, prayers are offered for those souls in purgatory, waiting to get in heaven so they may have eternal peace. The difference between these two celebrations is just simple, and I hope that you guys will remember to slow your misconception. Again, I'm Caleb, and that's it for now. Bye!
Ever since, All Souls Day is observed in churches and cemeteries across the country, with people giving their prayers and offerings. Keep in mind, though, that this holy holiday isn't only limited to the Philippines, for it is also celebrated in many other countries like Mexico, Ecuador, Hungary, and France. Filipino Roman Catholics usually visit cemeteries and attend Mass during All Souls Day. It is in their tradition to light a candle for their departed loved ones at church or their graves and then offer them a prayer.
We Catholics usually attend Mass and pray the Holy Rosary during All Souls Day. Some of the prayers that we say during this day are the Catholic Collect from Mass of the Dead, Requiem Aeternam, Benedictine Collect for All Souls Day, Invocation for the Souls in Purgatory, Lithuanian All Souls Day Prayer, Prayer to Our Suffering Savior for the Holy Souls in Purgatory, and the 9-day Novena Prayers for the Souls in Purgatory.
In addition, they also pray for them using the Holy Rosary, offer them lovely flowers, and sometimes, even a mass.
I remember our priest telling us to enjoy our pista minatay. At first, hindi ko talaga siya naiintindihan, but it actually means Feast of the Dead in Hiligaynon. So, pista minatay is a tradition where us Filipinos pay a visit to our dearly departed loved ones, and we pay a visit to them. So, this starts from October 31 to November 2.
In the Philippines, All Souls Day means having a small reunion because relatives and families get together to visit their late loved ones' graves and have a mini feast or solemn celebration.
Hello, I'm Anthony. If you do not know, I'm one of the other servers studying here in the Quantum Academy Incorporated. Now today I will be sharing to you the top foods that are being prepared in All Souls Day. Now these are just based on my personal experience, and it's based on what I have observed on every celebration that there is. Number one, spaghetti. Spaghetti is a classic. You can't miss it in every All Souls Day celebration. Number two, ginataan. Ginataan is called ginataan in many areas here in the Philippines, especially in Luzon, but in a Cebuano term, you might call it as pinignit. Number three, pancit. Pancit is also a common. It's a classic delicacy here in the Philippines, and you might even see it in a non-All Souls Day celebration, like in a birthday party or in another occasion. Number 4, chicken adobo. Chicken adobo is personally my favorite, and based on what I have observed, it's always the first dish that will disappear at the table. Number 5, menudo. If you do not know menudo, it's a traditional stew that is made with pork and liver and is cooked in tomato sauce with carrots and potatoes. Lastly, kakanin. Kakanin is a very general term because there are so many different types to it. For me, it's the most important snack because it just can't be absent, or An All-Souls Day celebration won't be there without the kapanin. Many other types of it, such as ube mahablangka, puto bombong, pananbiko, suman, bibingka, palitaw, and many others.
Aros Valenciana, biko, sapin-sapin, and kutsinta are four of the most popular foods during this holiday. We dedicate this day to honor, commemorate, and pray for the ones who have passed away.
How Filipinos celebrate All Souls Day goes in line with how we, as a culture, value our family and loved ones. And this includes how we honor our departed during this holiday. So while All Souls Day is officially celebrated on November 2, Filipinos love to start early. Families will start flocking the cemeteries by October 31, and it will usually turn into this huge collective affair of reunions where family and friends will gather around. They will visit the graves and mausoleums of their departed. They will share stories in remembrance. They will share food, like in the salo-salo. And some will even bring their tents so that they can spend at least a night or two with their departed. There are also various practices that vary depending on the family's cultural beliefs. Like some families will light candles, some will offer prayers, and some will even burn incense. It really depends.
All Souls Day is truly important to Roman Catholics because this is the day in which we pray for the eternal peace of the souls of the departed. We pray that the Lord may have mercy on their souls so that they may be able to enter the gates of heaven. Furthermore, it is also the time in which we remember them and show them our love, despite them not being here with us anymore. On this holy day, we must instill these three things in our hearts and minds: love, remembrance, and praise. Well, it's time for us to part now, for as we all know, the light comes after the dark. Tune in next episode to see which people and topics we'll be shining the light on next. Once again, I'm Clarissa Mila, sharing the spotlight, and right now, you're watching Spotlife. As always, let's spread the news in you. Thank you, and lights out.
Clarice totally answered all our questions, right, girls?
Yes, definitely. It was such an informative piece by Clarice, and it feels so good to know more about a holiday that we spent our whole lives celebrating.
I agree. And honestly, I do feel a closer connection with my loved ones that passed away. And it made me understand the importance of All Souls Day even more.
But don't you think it's funny and weird how the Philippines always prepare for All Souls Day? Why not celebrate other holidays too, like Halloween?
Oh yes, I've always wanted to celebrate Halloween. By the way, we do have an extraordinary person who grew up in a country where Halloween is a big deal. Guess who it is?
Oh, that's me.
Oh wow, you're really for our audience again?
Well, so, Bestie Marielle, what's Halloween like in the States?
Well, let me tell you, it is one of the best holidays ever. Scary decorations wherever you go, and no one makes fun of you if you're wearing the craziest costume. You know, the best part of Halloween has got to be trick-or-treating. I can even remember my sister and I looting every single house that we could possibly find and trading our Halloween candy when we were done with the night. Oh my god, I miss it already.
Ooh, I know. Why don't we change into our costumes to, you know, feel the Halloween vibe?
You know what? That sounds like a great idea. And it wouldn't even take us a second.
Oh my god, you look so cute, Mario!
Oh my god, thank you so much, Rihanna! And on the other hand, you are the perfect Snow White.
Thank you very much.
And you're welcome.
By the way, we're Sevi, and which princess you will be dressing up today?
I'm actually really curious.
Hi guys!
Hi, Sevi!
Hi, you look so pretty! You look so cute! Oh my god, I love your costumes!
Thank you so much!
Well, now, this seems like the perfect time to think and talk about a holiday full of treats, tricks, fun, and mischief. It's time to think talk with Brennan Chua. Brennan, take it away.
Think talk, what time is it? Oh, it's time for think talk. Hi, I'm Brennan, and this is think talk, where we discuss trivia, facts, and stories that will surely blow your mind. From history to pop culture, we've got it all covered. So without further ado, let's dive right into today's topic.
I'm back!
And now it's story time.
The street was ill-lit that night, and the silence was deafening. Only the dark outlines of the houses and the endless rows of streetlights lining up the pavements and the occasional buzz of an inquisitive insect could be seen and heard. Breaking the silence, there was a loud creak, like a door opening. Suddenly, all the other doors in the neighborhood opened, and the voices of bright-eyed and bushy-tailed children filled the air. They were all dressed in bizarre outfits and holding a bright orange pumpkin-shaped basket made of plastic. I felt a surge of excitement as I caught sight of them. That was my first and last experience of trick-or-treating, a traditional Halloween custom in some countries. While wearing a magician's costume and holding a jack-o'-lantern bucket, I went from house to house, witnessing tricks and receiving sweets as treats. By the time I had been everywhere, my bucket was overflowing. I was ecstatic! As I look back on this experience, my curiosity concerning the origin of this extraordinary holiday was triggered. Tons of thoughts and questions raced through my mind. How did Halloween begin? Why wear such costumes? Is this holiday evil? Why celebrate monsters? With this, I whipped out my laptop and did some research. By following the roots of Halloween, we come upon Samhain, an ancient Gaelic festival marking the end of summer and the harvest season and the beginning of winter. By the way, did you know that the Celts also called the beginning of winter as the darker half of the year, as it was associated with human death? Back in the day, during the night of October 31, the Celts, who lived 2,000 years ago, mostly in the area that is now Ireland, the United Kingdom, and Northern France, celebrated Samhain, believing that it was the day of the ghosts of the departed returned to Earth. Furthermore, the Celts celebrated their New Year on November 1. Because of this, many of their rituals were related to spirits. Lengthy shadows casted by enormous fires, and people dressed in eerie costumes made from animal heads and skins were common sights during Samhain. The Celts built huge bonfires, burning crops and animals as an offering to their deities, and wore costumes to ward off any unkind spirits, or even to disguise themselves as spirits. How awesome is that? With the arrival of the Romans in Celtic lands came Christianity, transforming their traditions to include figures in the said religion. Samhain became All Saints' Day, or All Hallows' Day, a holiday dedicated to all saints of the Roman Catholic Church. All Hallows' Eve, meaning hallowed evening, would later develop into Halloween. Over time, Halloween evolved into a day of fun activities. These activities involve trick-or-treating, carving jack-o'-lanterns, doing scare pranks, attending festive gatherings, donning costumes, going to Halloween attractions, and eating treats. Much like Samhain, numerous children and adults dress in costumes depicting frightening supernatural creatures or fictional characters. In addition, the holiday has also incorporated terrifying beings such as ghosts, witches, vampires, and the like. Just as how Samhain was a festival of spirits. Thanks to the Celts, we now have Halloween, which is one of the most distinct and fun holidays celebrated worldwide. Wow! Who knew Halloween's origins could be so deep? Keep learning and you'll reach greater heights. Learn more and don't forget to have fun in the process. Again, I'm Brenna and I'll see you in the next episode of Think Talk. Bye!
Well, that just gave me goosebumps, and it made me want to celebrate Halloween even more.
I agree. I want to experience trick-or-treating, wear costumes everywhere I go, and eat candy all night until my stomach hurts.
Don't you worry, guys, because I promise to take you soon with me, and you'll have the best Halloween adventure of your life. Guaranteed.
Thank you so much, Muriel. We're going to look forward to that, aren't we, Debbie?
For sure. Remember to keep that promise, bestie.
All right, I will. And for our dear audience, it's time for us to take a break, so you better grab our snacks or maybe head to the bathroom.
Or you guys could stay and watch the ads.
Don't you worry, we'll be right back on Kaleidoscope. Welcome back to
Kaleidoscope.
Learning during the pandemic is definitely not easy, but thanks to our Quantum Academy staff, we were able to grow holistically through our screens.
It's time to give them the recognition they deserve after all their hard work and sacrifices they've done.
Let's welcome our teachers as the first family to be featured on Quantum at Home.
Good day, TKA community! I am Teacher Denise.
And I am Teacher Grace. The first family that we will feature on Quantum at Home is...
Of course, the Quantum family. Now, if you're ready, we welcome you to the humble home of our family.
Come in! Let's go!
When I was little, I found this tubular toy which appeared to me as a mini telescope, sitting on my grandmother's bookshelf. Its exterior had an eccentric art style, which caught my eye at first glance. Given that it piqued my curiosity, I grabbed it from the bookshelf and started exploring it. I noticed that it had an eyepiece, therefore I looked right into it. There was a breathtaking burst of colors, and it was as if an abstract art party was going on in there. Numerous odd-shaped mirrors reflecting images of loose bits of colored glass feasted my eye. It even had a bizarre pattern and intricate design that got me thinking. Is it an insane flower? A colorful wonderworld? Or a magical spell-casting device? By peeping through its viewer, I was taken to a whole other dimension. Moments after, I heard a gentle voice say, "That's my favorite toy, the kaleidoscope." It was my grandmother, and that was the time I discovered its name. As I was rotating the section containing the loose fragments, I watched the patterns change endlessly, just like life's countless possibilities. Life is like a kaleidoscope. For in every turn you make, you are surprised by another beautiful possibility. The ever-changing sequence of colors is actually the essence of the kaleidoscope. It creates a never-ending array of magnificent, repeating art.
The term kaleidoscope was derived from the Greek words kalos, eidos, and skopion, which directly translates to beautiful form to see. It was invented by Sir David Brewster in 1816 and patented in 1817. Though kaleidoscopes are mostly known as philosophical toys, their purpose was not strictly intended for that. Back in the day, it was intended for the use by designers and artists who took inspiration from its beautiful patterns. The device made its next leap forward in 1873, in which Charles Busch patented several improvements. He added liquids of different densities, a stand that could easily be disassembled for portability, and a rotating wheel to expand the variety of possible designs. According to Melanie F. F. Gibbs, perhaps Busch's most ingenious advance, though, came in the form of special ampules. Busch's patent specified ampules with two or more liquids of different densities or character, or liquid with a solid or solids. Busch wrote that the liquids within the ampules should be able to mix, and each would have its own color. This allowed for even more intricate designs.
In the next century, an exhibition at Maryland Strathmore Hall Art Center featured more than 100 kaleidoscopes and drew great interest. This paved way for radio, television, and motion pictures to push kaleidoscopes chiefly into children's hands. Shortly after, the Brewster Kaleidoscope Society for Kaleidoscope Enthusiasts was soon established. Kaleidoscopes have truly come a long way in the last 200 years. Today, the Society lists about 125 kaleidoscope artists among its members who focus on turning this philosophical optical device into various unique art. Not only that, but there's also a wide range of different types of kaleidoscopes available at present. Truly, the kaleidoscope is a beautiful form to see, which explains why it is a toy or instrument that never goes away. Its phenomenal and distinct design is what makes it irreplaceable despite the countless new artworks and artistic inventions produced in the last 200 years. Without a doubt, the kaleidoscope is a timeless device that stands out in its own unique way.
We're back, and once again, welcome to Quantum at Home. So, Teacher Grace, upon hearing the word kaleidoscope, what comes into your mind, sir?
It's my childhood memories. Mm-hmm. It will keep on flashing on my mind because kaleidoscope toy is one of those toys that I used when I was still young.
Oh, really, sir? Funny because for me, I only know the song and not the toy. You know the title or the song entitled Kaleidoscope World by Francis M? You know that, sir?
Yes, yeah, I know that
song. Yeah, I
know.
I only know that. I didn't know that it was a toy.
Well, I think your generations mm-hmm. or the younger generation will share a same sentiment as you, Teacher Denise.
As me, okay. So, what about it, sir?
Okay, so that is why, Teacher Denise, on this segment of the kaleidoscope, we are going to show you how we are going to make our own kaleidoscope toy.
Ooh, that's
and
exciting.
Teacher Denise,
yes, sir.
Here's the fun part.
What is it?
We are just going to use materials that are found at home.
Wow, really interesting. So I'm very excited about it, sir. Shall we now begin?
Of course. So let's get started.
Now, to get started, we need to prepare the materials such as an empty tissue paper tube. We have here a glitter paper, a mirrored paper, and then a clear plastic. I hope it's visible. We have here a pair of scissors, a pen. You may use a pencil or a marker, a ruler, very important. We have here washi tape and a regular tape, and of course some beads.
You can use alternative materials if not available. For instance, if you didn't have glitter paper, you may use construction, art paper, or even a gift wrapper. Mm-hmm. For the mirrored paper, you can use any reflective paper or even paper plate. And then for a piece of clear plastic, you can cut from those disposable food containers.
That's perfect, Teacher Grace. Now, Q-Kids, always remember, being resourceful is the key.
So, Teacher Denise, what are we going to do with all the materials that we have here?
All right, now, first things first, it's time to cover the tube with some glitter paper.
So, of course, we have here the tissue paper tube and the glitter paper. We are going to use a hot glue to attach the glitter paper to tissue paper tube.
Okay, let me help you, Teacher Grace.
Okay.
So we should apply it here first on this side. So reminder, teacher, what should we remind them?
Okay, so by the way, Q-Kids, be careful with the hot glue so that you will not hurt yourself because this is quite risky to use.
Yeah, that's right. Thank you for that reminder, Teacher Ray, especially the kids. You know, the kids, they have to be really careful in using the hot glue. our tube covered. So, Teacher Grace, if ever there's an excess paper, what should we do about it?
So, we should cut it out to make it look cleaner.
Okay, so that's right. Since we used a glitter paper, Teacher Grace, I think it's a very good choice. As you can see, it looks fancy, it looks extra, it's shining, shimmering, splendid, right, sir?
All right, that is really true.
Okay.
All right, so I think, Teacher Denise, it's time for us to move on to the next step, which is the second step.
Okay, the step two.
So I have a question, Teacher Denise.
What is it, sir?
Are you ready?
Of course, sir. I was born ready. So what should we do next?
Okay, Teacher Denise, so I want you to put the tube aside.
Okay.
And because, why am I doing this? Why am I letting you put that one aside?
Mm-hmm.
That's because we are going to create the inside of our kaleidoscope toy to make a triangle out of this mirrored paper.
Yeah, this mirrored paper.
Okay. Using your ruler, pen, and scissors, cut out a 4 by 4.5 area from the mirrored paper.
Okay, so since our mirrored paper is a cutout from a
paper plate.
So now we have here the measurement. What is it again, sir? The measurement?
It's 4 by 4.5 area.
Okay. Again, kids, if you can't do it on your own, you have to ask help from an adult. Maybe your mom, their dad, or their ate.
After which, we'll make two folds to make a triangle. Okay, so now that we have our triangle, thank you, Teacher Denise.
Right.
So we have to use a tape, a regular one, to secure it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let me help Teacher Denise. So now that we have a triangle, Teacher Denise, time to slide this one into the tube.
Okay.
So may I know where's your shining, shimmering tube?
Of course, it's right here, sir.
Okay, so be gentle while you insert the triangle cue, kids. And let's go and do this, Teacher Denise.
Okay,
so here we go. And here it is. Now, what's the next step, Teacher Denise?
Okay, so now we're down to the third step. All right, so cute kids, hold your clear plastic, your pen, and the covered tube. Because to have a full functioning kaleidoscope, we need to cover the tube with an end cap.
Take a piece of your clear plastic and using the tip of the toilet tissue tube, trace out two circles.
Okay.
Okay.
So?
Now we are going to cut them out along the insides of your line. And one circle should be trimmed down a little more because we need to make sure that it would be able to fit and lay flat on the inside of the kaleidoscope. Okay, so let's try this one. Okay, it's perfect. Very good, Teacher Denise.
Again,
so let's
the bigger one.
Okay,
I'm not yet done with the bigger one.
Okay.
Okay, let's try if it could cover the tube. All right, so I think that's it. Okay. What should we do next, teacher?
Now it's time to make the rotating mechanism using this second toilet paper tube.
Okay, so what should we do, teacher?
So we have to cut a piece about an inch wide.
An inch.
Okay, about 1 inch. And okay. Then, after taking that piece of the tube, we have to make a cut in the middle.
Like this, sure.
Yes. Okay, so you're doing great, Teacher Denise. Mm-hmm.
And what's next?
Okay, so after that, Teacher Denise, you have to fold it over half an inch and secure it with a tape.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Teacher Grace, let me help Teacher Denise with the tape.
Give me a clear tape.
So this will be the end of the end cup.
Okay, so I think sure we have to cover it with a, what do you call this one?
Washi tape.
Washi tape to have a cleaner look, right
okay.
Sure?
So okay. let's try to cover that one.
Okay, and I think that's it. Let's see it if it would fit inside our tube.
Okay, it's perfect.
All right, this is nice. Oh, I think we're almost done, sure. Now what should we do next?
Now that the end cup is covered, get your second plastic circle mm-hmm. and cover the top of the end cup and secure it with a tape.
Okay, so let's start, sure.
Finally, the end cup is now done.
Oh, now I think of all the steps, I think this one's pretty easy.
Yes, okay. That's right.
Now, anyways, Kaleidoscope is incomplete without its mesmerizing patterns. Now, Q-Kids, hold your bids. Make sure that your bids are in vibrant colors, just like this one. We have colors green, orange, blue, and we have some what do you call that one though, this one, sure,
glitters.
Okay, so that's it. Now we have to fill the end of the cup with some beads, then attach it back to the vase. Don't forget to glue this with a hot glue. Sure, can you please help me so that it won't move?
Yes, sure. All right.
And now we have here a fully functioning kaleidoscope.
Yes, Teacher Denise, we did a pretty good job, didn't we?
Yes, of course. So, should we test it now?
Yes, I want
to
test it now.
Okay, I want to be the first one to test it out.
Okay,
what can
so
you say, teacher?
It is somewhat the same from those from my toy,
okay.
Kaleidoscope toy. Thanks for watching, and always remember to use your imagination and let your creativity to flow out of you.
And once again, this is Teacher Denise.
And this is Teacher Grace.
Spreading the use in you.
I'm totally going to try to make a kaleidoscope when I have time. The teachers made it look so easy to do.
Give me a call when you're going to make it. I'd love to see you try.
Okay, while you guys are over there talking about your kaleidoscope plans, allow me to introduce Miss Giselle Parrott for our next segment on The Scoops.
Hello, cute kids. I am Layla. Welcome to your up-to-date source of lifestyle trends and human interest. As they say, The Scoops. For today, we will scoop up some movies, specifically PG-13 movies, that do not need an R rating to be blood-curdling. So sit back, relax, and enjoy. Is there a way for young teenagers to watch a horror film that's appropriate for them without having to risk the older audience's enjoyment. Both young teenagers and adults who have had enough courage or thought they had to watch these films have already regretted their big kid and grown-up decisions. And it's only the first few minutes into the movies. PG-13 horror movies like A Quiet Place 2018 have answered this ever-haunting question of mine. This movie has exhibited how the characters lived in deadly silence in which a single sound would cost them their life. While beating the daylights out of aliens that had supersonic hearing, it was either the aliens got to them or the silence ate them alive, whichever came first. With tension that brings you on the edge of your seat and eye-opening discussions about real-life family issues, my money is set on this one. For the lovers of this horror film, you should also watch its sequel, A Quiet Place Part 2, 2020, which is also rated PG-13. For those of you who are amused by malevolent spirits and cries of agony, this one's for you, Insidious, 2010. Moreover, this paranormal thriller and the Conjuring movie were directed by the same director. The dark already made my blood run cold when I was little, and this movie didn't help with that at all. Lights Out, 2016. It's about Rebecca's brother who's experiencing unexplained, terrifying events caused by a supernatural spook who could only haunt in the dark. The entity, who holds a mysterious attachment to their mother, has returned with a vengeance to torment the entire family and jeopardize their safety and sanity. Seriously, this film kept me up all night. Couldn't sleep. Watching horror movies may be entertaining for some, but what if I told you the horror film you just watched would mysteriously kill you right after? Good thing this next movie is not about a horror film, but a nightmarish videotape. The Ring, 2002. Is a movie about a tape that shows spine-chilling images and inexplicably kills its viewers after 7 days. Undoubtedly, this spectacular, eerie film that makes you rooted to the spot while still wanting more perfectly fits the idiom proverb, curiosity killed the cat. Next, we have The Exorcism of Emily Rose. Like, how is this movie even rated PG-13? Plagued by horrifying visions and tormented by sinister manifestations, the troubled young Catholic girl, Emily Rose, who is believed to be possessed by 6 demons, was subjected to exorcism only to die a horrible death. The priest who was responsible for the failed exorcism of Emily Rose was then charged with negligent homicide, which led to more riveting events. Indeed, this movie challenges your sanity with a gripping storyline. Last but not the least, we have Mama, 2013. I watched this movie with a slack jaw and eyes brimmed with tears of terror. It's about 2 young sisters and a disturbing disposition due to the horrifying spirit of their deceased mother that followed their every step. A horror film with a touch of drama, an old-fashioned ghost story about the unquiet spirit of an obsessed mother, a not-so-happy family, and an unsettling, bittersweet ending. This movie would certainly get you hooked, but also make you cover your eyes every 5 minutes. These are some of the highest rated PG-13 horror movies that prove scary does not need an R rating. We may not be able to go out this Halloween, but we can still feel the spirit of the spooky season by watching these nail-biting chillers with our families. Roll the credits! That's it! I hope you were thrilled by these movie scoops. Once again, this has been Layla. See you in our next scoops. Continue spreading the hues in you. Goodbye!
So, which one of the movies have you guys watched already? I'm a huge fan of horror films, so I basically watched most of them.
Oh my god, really? You know, Rihanna and I are actually more into rom-coms.
And it's like, really ironic that we're older.
Yeah.
Debbie's the only one who has the guts to watch horror movies.
Yeah, that's true. Well, don't worry. Let's have a horror movie night sometime to get over your fears.
All right, let's give it a shot. I'm pretty sure it won't even hurt to try.
Well, the three of us are going to find what horror movie you should watch for our movie night.
While we're at it, it's time for another break.
Oh, and don't go anywhere, besties, because the three of us will be right back with you on Teas and Stories.
finally, it's time to experience Merge EDU for yourself. With Merge EDU, you will hold a digital object in your hand for the first time and experience the learning potential. Place digital objects in the real world and walk around to inspect them up close. Try out one of more than 100 science simulations inside Merge Explorer. See why our more than 1,000 digital teaching aids are a powerful alternative to physical models inside Merge Object Viewer. And bring the classroom to life with fun and engaging activities and STEM projects. Visit dashboard.mergeedu.com to access Merge resources and helpful Getting Started articles. If you have any questions or suggestions, you can always reach out to us by email at support@mergeedu.com. We hope you have fun learning with Merge EDU. You're my kaleidoscope!
Want to spread good vibes.
We want to encourage learning.
We want to inspire.
Welcome to Teens and Stories,
the last segment of the Kaleidoscope where we talk about anything under the sun.
You bet.
Once again, I'm Rihanna.
I'm Debbie.
And I'm Mariel.
And we're your lovely Kaleidoscope hosts.
Girls, I think this quarantine is taking forever. Don't you think?
True, the number of COVID-19 cases will stop increasing.
Absolutely, I miss the old normal so much. And it also makes me really sad because we just celebrated All Souls Day, yet we couldn't go visit the grave or anybody's loved ones. You know, my parents think it's just a better idea for us to stay at home and pray for them.
Oh, I totally feel you, sis.
I'm so sorry to hear that, sis. But you just gave me an idea.
Ooh, really? Come on, spill it.
All right. For today's topic on Teas and Stories, we'll be brainstorming and talking about simple ways on how to commemorate our late loved ones at home. You know, just in case we still couldn't go out next year. Hopefully not, though. Or this could also apply to the people who just couldn't visit the memorial parks and cemeteries even without the pandemic.
You know what? That's a great idea.
I agree. Oh, wait, I have an idea.
Oh, wow, that was fast.
I know, right? So come on, what is it, Debbie?
Well, we can prepare and enjoy a meal with the family. And to remember our loved ones in heaven, we could cook their favorite foods. You know, like what George Bernard Shaw once said, there's no love sincerer than the love of food.
Oh, you know what? I'd love that. And if other members of the family cannot physically join the table, we can just schedule an online virtual toast and remember the people that we're remembering on All Souls Day.
That's right, besties. Also, we could have a movie or TV series marathon with the family. I mean, why not stream our loved ones' favorite movies or series? And to make things even more special, we could enjoy the show together with his or her favorite go-to snack and signature sip.
That sounds like fun. Oh, speaking of which, I think we could also play their favorite games with the family. It could be a video game, board games, or anything.
Oh my god, you know, those all sound so great. Especially since we could bond with the family at the same time. By the way, guys, you gave me an idea. Why don't we sing their favorite songs by doing the typical Filipino ritual, which is renting a karaoke.
Wait, no, what do you mean by Filipino ritual? What? No.
Not the karaoke.
Okay, guys, aside from that, we could also prepare positive speeches about them. You know, it's always so nice and meaningful to just reminisce about the days that we shared with our late loved ones. You know, so like, let's break the madness vibe by sharing hilarious, heartwarming, and unforgettable stories about them with our friends and family.
That sounds so wholesome, Mariel. It reminds me of after-party bonding moments with my family and relatives. Gosh, I really miss those days. Oh, anyway, I got another one. We could also order their favorite foods. For sure, there were lots of times when our late loved ones would order food for takeout or delivery. Days when they would crave for milk tea, sushi, pizza, or you know, anything like that. Ooh, why not we order some of their favorite foods now? It's been a long time, don't you think?
Oh my god, you know what? I think I'll do that later.
You guys are making me hungry. Well, enough of food and listen to what I got.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm hungry too, but please go on.
How about bringing out their best love displays? Whether it's a replica of a Van Gogh painting they love, an autographed Queen poster, or a customized lampshade from a Suki local shop. We could bring it out for old time's sake and exhibit it to remember them by.
Oh, Debbie, that is actually so sweet.
I know, right?
Okay, guys, last idea. You gotta hear me out on this one. So why can't we also create a memory table?
How would you do that?
Oh my god, it is so easy. So, we could spare a part of our house in which we can prepare a simple shrine for our late loved ones. We can do this by setting up a small table with photos of them, maybe some fresh flowers, scented candles, and basically anything that may remind us of them.
Oh wait, that's so lovely. But speaking of shrine, I think we're forgetting something a little more important, like praying for their souls.
Oh my god, you're right. I'm so sorry.
For us Roman Catholics, we could simply light a candle and pray for their souls using the Holy Rosary. That's what my family and I did last All Souls Day.
Yes, oh my god, you know, I also believe I read somewhere that we could light candles virtually for our departed loved ones through the UNDEF online website, which added new features on October 9th to help Catholics like me endure the Filipino tradition. And you know what? The online CBCP-run platform allows us to light lights accompanied with a video prayer for the dead. And I've actually tried this one, y'all.
Yep, and we could also send prayer requests online. As a matter of fact, we can do this through the UNDAS online website under the prayer request section. Different prayer requests such as Thanksgiving and petitions are also available. I read it on an article.
Really? So does that mean we could also offer a mass for our departed loved ones through that website?
Mm-hmm. We could submit the names of our departed loved ones to be included in the mass through the prayer request section on UNDAS online website. We can even order an online e-mass card for the COVID-19 victims and for frontliners with any amount of donation made on the Radio Veritas website.
Well, that's amazing.
And heartwarming. Also, you guys, let's not forget to also mention attending mass for our departed loved ones. We can hear mass online from live streaming in All Saints and All Souls Day.
Oh yes, that is so true.
That's right.
Oh my god, guys, we actually came up with so many ideas. And to be honest, I'm liking these ideas better than just going to the memorial park and visiting the graves of our departed loved ones. Don't you think? Anyway, thanks a lot, you guys.
We are sisters. We always help each other.
And don't mention it. Thanks to you guys, too. Now I have better plans next All Souls Day, with or without the pandemic.
Oh my god, I had so much fun talking with the both of you, but I'm so sad and I wish we could talk more, but I believe we're gonna have to end this segment now.
Oh, right. Well, let's all FaceTime later instead.
Oh, bet. I'm up for that.
Great. Let's end the segment now.
All right. Teachers, students, and staff of the Quantum Academy, there are many different ways for us to commemorate our departed loved ones while staying safe in the comfort of our own homes. Let's all remember them with our families and pray for their souls. Lastly, may we all stay safe and healthy, and may God bless us all. Once again, we are your lovely Kaleidoscope hosts, and this is Cheese and Stories, spreading good vibes,
encouraging learning,
and inspiring people.
So, guys, I have a question to ask. How does it feel like to have a relative that who is close to you and have passed away? Like, I really don't know what your emotions about this are.
Well, based on my experience, I actually had my Lola who passed away a long time ago when I was really little. But that doesn't mean that our moments were really precious, and there's not a day where I don't stop thinking about him.
As for me, I had an uncle who died 5 to 6 years ago. We were really close, and we would watch movies all the time. And I still miss him to this day, and, well, all of our family misses him.
Well, this is the literal meaning of you need to always spend with your relatives every day so that you will miss them. Yeah, like that, yeah.
I had a great time learning about All Souls Day and Halloween. I'm sure you guys did too. But before we end the show, it's time for today's Kaleidoscope that fits this episode's theme. Drum roll, please. The life of the dead is placed in the memory of the living, by Marcus Tullius Cicero.
Wow, that quote sure does speak volumes. It reminds us that those who passed away are never really gone because they're always in our hearts.
You know, I agree with you 100%, Debbie. And just like what Clarice and Brennan said, All Souls Day and Halloween were first created to remember our departed loved ones.
And we should also remember that All Souls Day is not the only time to remember and commemorate our departed loved ones. We could always pray for them every day.
Same thing goes for Halloween. You know, you can never go wrong with wearing your favorite Halloween costume.
Mm-hmm, indeed. Anyway, I guess it's time to end the first episode of The Kaleidoscope.
Geez, time sure does fly fast when you're having fun. Right, girls?
Mm-hmm. You're right. Mm-hmm. All right, I really hope you guys enjoyed this episode as much as we did making it. Stay tuned to the next episode of Kaleidoscope every end of the month.
A place where every color,
every hue,
represented by me and you. Once again, this is Kaleidoscope.
Spreading the hues in you.
Turning my life around, violets and purples, diamonds and circles. You're my kaleidoscope. I love every minute, you've got me in it. You're my kaleidoscope. Tonight, I hate.